Sirambar, in the last lecture, we were confronted with this question. Given a basis B star for V star, is there a basis B for V such that this B star is a dual for that basis B? Okay. The answer is yes, and we will prove that today. We need the notion of the double dual. So what is a double dual? The double dual is just V double star, okay. Over R, let us say, real vector space, then the double dual of V, denoted by V double star, is defined by V double star is V star star. Okay, that is a double dual. It is the vector space of all functionals on V star. It is a vector space of all linear functionals on V star. That is a double dual. Now for we will now establish a correspondence between V and V double star as follows. So the objective first is to establish a correspondence. Let me take X in V. I will define a functional. I will define Lx of f to be equals L of Lx of f is fx for every f in V star. I am defining a functional on V star. So I am defining an element in V double star, provided of course I show that Lx is linear. So first let me show that Lx is linear. Let me show that Lx is linear. Then it would follow that this Lx of, see, this Lx acts on V star. If I had shown Lx is linear, it follows that Lx belongs to V double star. Okay, okay. Let us prove that first, that Lx is linear. To prove Lx is linear, I must show that Lx of alpha f plus g equals alpha Lf plus Lg. So let us look at Lx of alpha f plus g. F and g come from V star. F and g come from V star. Consider Lf, Lx of alpha f plus g. By definition, this is alpha f plus g of x. But this is addition of functionals, we know, is pointwise. So this is alpha fx plus g of x. Alpha fx, alpha times fx. So that is alpha Lx f plus gx is Lxg. So it follows that Lx is linear. Is that okay? So Lx is linear. That is, Lx belongs to V double star. Remember that it the domain of Lx is R. See, Lx of f is fx. F is a linear function. So f of x is a real number. So Lx is a function from V star to R. Lx is a function from V star to R. So it is a functional. We have shown it is a linear function. Okay. So for every x in V, there is an Lx. Now, can it happen that this Lx is 0? Do we have plenty of these Lx? That will be answered by the next theorem. But let us quickly observe that if x is not equal to 0, then Lx cannot be 0. If x is not 0, we will show that Lx cannot be the 0 functional. Okay. x is not equal to 0. Look at if lx is a 0 functional, then what it means is that lx of f equals 0 for all f. A function is 0 if it takes the value 0 for every x in the domain. So if lx is a 0 functional, then lx f is 0 for all f in V star. But lx f is by definition fx. Fx equals 0 for all f in V star. Can we conclude from this that x is 0? How? Yes? Okay, so there are at least two ways. One is a little long winding. The other one is to simply identify that since this is true for all f linear functions, one could take the identity function. Identity linear functional. Identity linear function. Identity of x is x, so this means x equal to 0, contradiction to what we started with. So lx cannot be 0. So x not equal to 0 implies lx is not equal to 0. That is, if x is not 0, there is at least one functional f such that lx f is not 0. Okay. We want to show there are plenty of functions. Okay. This correspondence between x in V and lx in V double star, we will make it formal and prove the following theorem. Our concern is over finite dimensional vector spaces. Let V be a finite dimensional vector space define the function phi from V to V double star by means of this correspondence, by phi of x equals lx. Phi of x equals lx. See, what we now know now is that this lx indeed belongs to V double star, and the definition of lx for any fixed x is that lx of f for f in V star is equal to f of x. So this is this takes the vector x in V to an element in V double star. Okay, then what is the natural conclusion that one would like to draw? Phi is an isomorphism. So let's state this and prove. Then phi is an isomorphism. Then phi is an isomorphism. It is this result that will give a proof of the fact that for every basis B star in V star, there is a basis B for V such that this B star is a dual basis of that basis B, at least for finite dimensional spaces. Okay, so let's look at the proof of this theorem. I must show that so phi is an isomorphism is the claim. I must show that phi is linear. I must show phi is linear, phi is 1 to 1, phi is onto, then it follows that phi is an isomorphism. Phi is linear, that is the first thing. Let me consider phi of alpha x plus y. I must show that this is alpha phi of x plus phi of y. So look at phi of alpha x plus y. This by definition is L of this, L of alpha x plus y. I want to know what L of alpha x plus y is. So what I will do is look at the following. L of alpha x plus y, that is known if I know the action of this on f and v star. So L of alpha x plus y of f, this by definition is f of alpha x plus y. So remember, f is in v star, L is a functional on v star. Okay, so this is a number, f is in v star, this is a functional on v star, v double star. This is a functional on V star. There is an element in V double star. Okay. F is linear, alpha fx plus f of y. This is alpha fx, I have lxf plus fg is lxfy, lyf. Alpha fx plus fy, because f is linear, and then I go back to the definition of L subscript x. Lxf plus this. So I can write this as alpha Lx plus Ly acting on f. Okay. So now I know what L of alpha x plus y is. L of alpha x plus y is precisely alpha Lx plus Ly. So I will use that here. That is, if t of x equals s of x, then t equals s, t of x equals f of x, t equals s. So these functions are the same. So L of alpha x plus y is alpha Lx plus Ly. I again go back, alpha Lx is on the right phi x plus Ly is phi y. So I have shown that phi is linear. Phi of alpha x plus y is alpha phi of x plus phi of y. So phi is linear. I want to show first that phi is injective. So I know it is linear. So injectivity, I will show null space consists of just singleton 0. So I start with phi of x equal to 0, I will show x is equal to 0. Suppose that phi of x equal to 0, then Lx equal to 0. But Lx is a functional on V star. This means if a function is identically 0, it means its action on any element in the codomain is 0. So Lx of f is equal to 0 for all f in V star. Definition. Lx of f on the other hand is fx, fx equal to 0 for all f in V star as before. We have considered that here. Fx equal to 0 for all f in V star implies x is 0. So x is equal to 0. So I started with phi x equal to 0. I have shown that x is equal to 0. So it follows that phi is injective. It follows that phi is injective. To prove that phi is surjective, I will make use of the rank nullity dimension theorem. If I have a linear transformation on a vector space V, then I know that and it is finite dimension, then I know that it is 1-1 if and only if it is onto. Okay. Phi is a function from V to V double star. What is the dimension of V double star? The dimension of V star is a dimension of V. If V is finite dimension, dimension of V star is a dimension of V. That is the dimension of the dual space. It is the same as the dimension of the original space. The dimension of V double star should be the dimension of V star, because I am taking the same dual. V star is finite dimension I am using. So dimension of V is equal to dimension of V double star. Dimension of V is equal to dimension of V double star. So, and I have shown that this is a phi, this is a linear injective map. So it must be, by rank nullity dimension theorem, this must be surjective also. Phi is surjective also. So phi is an isomorphism. Okay, so that is the proof. So phi is an isomorphism, which is what we wanted to prove. Okay, so let us now look at two consequences. The first corollary of this theorem let V be finite dimensional and L belong to V double star. So let me say L be a linear functional on V star. Then there exists a unique f in V star such that there exists a unique V is finite dimensional, L is a linear function of V star, then there exists a unique X in V such that L of F equals F of X for all F in V star. This is an immediate consequence of the previous theorem. Linear functional on V star, so L belongs to V double star. Okay. Linear functional on V star, so it's an element of V double star. Okay. Proof. L is a linear function on V star, so L belongs to V double star. The previous theorem exhibits an isomorphism, explicit isomorphism, phi from V to V double star by phi of X equals L of X. It means that for any L and V double star, there exists an X such that phi of X equals L of X. We have established that this phi is an isomorphism. Now look at what you have on the right. This function is onto. So for any L and V double star, there is an X such that phi of X is equal to that L. Okay. So by the previous theorem, there exists X element of V such that phi of X equals L by the previous theorem. Phi is onto, that is what I am using here. So anything in V double star has a pre-image in V, so that is my X. But since phi is an isomorphism, this X must be unique, and so X is unique because phi is an isomorphism. The other thing is phi X, the definition is Lx. So this L is equal to Lx. The form of the L is also known. This is equal to Lx for some unique vector X in V. So this Lx equals L. L is equal to Lx. So L is equal to Lx. So if you look at the action of L on F, it is the same as the action of Lx on F. But Lx on F, I know that's the evaluation functional. That's Fx. So what I have shown is Lf is equal to Fx, that X is unique. So it's almost a one-line proof, right, from the previous theorem. Okay, so remember that we have made use of the fact that phi is onto here. Phi is onto, so for any L and V double star, there is a pre-image. This pre-image must be unique because phi is an isomorphism, phi is injective. And so there exists an X such that this happens. But then what is the definition of phi? Phi of X is Lx. So this L is equal to Lx. Write down what this definition Lx means. We have written it. It's an evaluation functional. So the L that I started with in V double star must satisfy this equation. Okay. This is one consequence. The other consequence is what I mentioned right in the beginning. This correspondence between a basis for V star and a basis for V. In fact, there exists a unique basis. There exists a unique basis. I can include that also. Given a basis V star of V star, this theorem states that if V is finite dimensional, then there is a basis B of V such that this B star is a dual of the basis B. Okay, this is again a consequence of the previous theorem, really the previous corollary. So proof is as follows. I will start with the basis B star. I can write down the elements explicitly. B star is let us say F1, F2, etc., Fn. Let B star be a basis of V star. V star is finite dimensional, I have a basis corresponding to this, there is a dual basis. Let B double star equal to corresponding to any basis in a finite dimensional vector space, there is a dual basis. So let B double star equal, oh I am sorry, please remember that this B double star should not be, this is just a notation, okay. See, we will later identify V double star with V. So this is just, please remember this is just a notation. Maybe I can, okay, I will just leave it as it is. See, this is, I am writing down, this is the notation for a basis in V double star, basis for V double star. So B double star equals, let me say L1, L2, etc., LN. I know that the number of elements in this must be the same as the number of elements in B star. Let this be the dual basis corresponding to B, sorry, corresponding to B star. Then I know how these are related. Then Li of Fj, this is delta ij. Fi of Uj equals delta ij. Uis are replaced by Fis, Uj's are replaced by Fj's, Fs are replaced by L. Now look at each Li. Each Li is in V double star. This is a basis of this is a basis of V double star. Okay, this is a basis of V double star. Each is an element in V double star. By the previous corollary, each element has a preimage. Okay. For every I, there exists a unique Ui. That is what the previous theorem said. There exists unique Ui such that unique Ui in V. Let us get back to the previous result. For every L in V double star, there exists a unique X such that phi of X equals L. For every I, there exists Ui in V such that Lx equals L. Tell me if this is all right. I will use Ui. L Ui equals Li. Instead of L in the previous corollary, I have Li. Instead of Lx, I have L Ui. For every I can do this. Take L1 for instance. Take I equal to 1 for instance. I am looking at L1. L1 is in V double star, there is a unique pre-image, I am calling that U1. How are these two related? L is equal to Lx is the previous theorem, L1 equal to LU1. I do this for all I, Li equals LUi for all I. This is okay. Collect these Uis. It is natural to expect these Uis form a basis for V. We will only prove independence, then it follows that these vectors form a basis. Okay. So I will collect Uis. Is the construction clear? Let us set B as U1, U2, etc., UN. then we show. So the claim is that this B is a basis for V such that B star is dual to this. These two things we have to prove. This B is a basis, and the fact that the B star that we started with is dual to this. Okay, is it clear that it's enough to show that this is independent, linearly independent? It is linearly independent. The number of elements is n. The dimension of V is n, so it must be a basis. So we'll show independence of this, linear independence of this. So you start with a linear combination, equate that to zero. Suppose alpha 1 u 1 plus alpha 2 u 2 etc. is zero. We must show that each scalar is 0. If this is a 0 vector, I apply a linear functional f of 0 is 0. Apply f is in V star. Take any linear functional on V and then apply f to this. So I get alpha 1 f of u 1 plus alpha 2 f of u 2 etc. alpha n f of u n. This is 0. But f of u 1, you go back to this. F of u 1 is L1 of F. Agreed? F of U1 is L1 of F. Say I'm using this really. Use this. L1 of F is evaluation of F at U1, right? This equation tells us that Li of F is F at Ui, because Lui is the evaluation function. Lx is fx. Lx of f is fx. So Li of f is Lui of f. Let me write down. L also, something that we have used already. Also, Li of f is Lui of f, because each L and V double star, for each L and V double star there is a unique X. Lui of, on the other hand, is F at Ui. Lx of F by definition is F at X. So Fui can be replaced in the above left hand side sum by Li of F. So alpha 1 L1 F plus alpha 2 L2 F etc. alpha n LNF is equal to 0. So remember, you need to apply carefully the appropriate argument. Is this okay? Now this is true for, I started with an arbitrary F, so this is true for all F. This is true for all F and V star. Do I have the required conclusion? I have something like Tx equals 0 for all x, so T must be the 0 map. Let me elaborate. So what this means is that alpha 1 L1 plus alpha 2 L2 etc. alpha n Ln, this acting on F, this is 0 for all F in V star. That is what this means. Alpha 1 L1 F plus alpha 2 L2 F etc. This is equal to 0 for F and V star means this. Because what is the definition of this is alpha 1 L1 F plus alpha 2 L2 F etc. Okay, so I have a function which for every point in the domain gives 0. So this function must be 0. but this is now an equation involving the basis vectors, basis functionals. Since L1 etcetera LN are linearly independent, it follows that each scalar is 0. Okay. And so we wanted to establish the linear independence of these vectors un etcetera un. I started with this combination. I have shown that each scalar is 0. So B is a basis. Basis for V. Why is B star dual to this? We must verify that Fi of uj equals delta ij. Okay. Also, Fi of uj equals Fi of uj, go back to this equation. Go back to this equation. Fi of uj, okay, let me write once again what I am using. Also, Li equals Lui, this is what I want to use. That is, these are elements in V double star, these are identical elements in V double star, so their action on F must be the same. Okay, that is Li of F is equal to Lui of F, but Lui of F is F of Ui for every F in V star. Okay, now consider Fi of uj. Consider Fi of uj. Fi of uj is Fi of uj, instead of I have j, L uj of Fi. Be careful with the indices here. I want Fi of uj, forget Fi for the moment, call it just F. I want F of uj. F of uj is L uj of F, L uj of F, but instead of F I have Fi, so it is L uj Fi. Is that okay? See, I want to show that B star is dual to this. I must show that Fi uj equals delta ij, so I am computing Fi uj. Fi uj, the definition comes from this. F of uj is L uj of F, but I want Fi of uj, so that is L uj of Fi, but L uj of Fi is equal to you can go back to that Li Fj equals delta. I could have restricted my attention to Li, but does not matter. Li Fj is delta ij, so this is equal to delta ij. Luj, okay, maybe one more step, right? Lj Fi, Lj Fi. Delta ij equals delta ji, delta ij equals delta ji, okay. So this is delta ij. This is actually delta ji, but delta ji is delta ij. Identity matrix is a symmetric matrix. Is it okay then? Fi uj equals delta ij. So the basis B star that we started with is in fact dual to the basis u1, u2, etcetera, un that we have constructed. Is it clear? So for every basis, for every dual basis, rather for every basis of V star, there exists a basis B of V such that the basis that we started with is the dual basis for B. Okay. Okay. Now there is one final section on on the double annihilator. I'll prove maybe one or two results on the double annihilator and one consequence. Now, before I discuss the double annihilator, say I want to discuss something like S double naught. I want to know whether this is equal to S. Any subset of V. First of all, does it make sense? First of all, this is a subset of V. S double annihilator is a subset of V double star. Whether this makes sense, we have to see. For that, you go back and look at this functional isomorphism phi from V to V double star defined by phi of x equals Lx. See, this establishes an isomorphism, a one-to-one correspondence between V and V double star. So what we do hereafter is, given any element in V double star, we will identify that with a unique element in V. This identification will enable us to think of V double star as being the same as V. This is identification. We will identify V double star with V. What is the basis for this identification? That is this isomorphism. Any L in V double star, we know, can be mapped to a unique X in V. So any L in V double star, there exists a unique X. So we can think of V double star as being the same as V in the rest of the discussion. That enables us to talk about S double annihilator being equal to S. Now, for any subset, this is not true. We need to look at subspaces. So for subspaces, we will prove this equation. Okay, that is the first result. So what I want to do is to prove this theorem that if you have S is a subset of a finite dimensional vector space V, then the double annihilator of S is equal to span of S. The double annihilator of S is equal to span of S. The reason why the right hand side cannot be an arbitrary subset is that it must be a subspace. See, when you take the annihilator, it is always a subspace. So the double annihilator is a subspace. We will show that this subspace is the same as span of S. The proof is as follows. Okay, so remember that these two are subsets of different spaces, but there is an identification that is possible by means of this isomorphism. It is with this identification in the mind that we will prove that these two subspaces are the same. Okay, let me set W as span of S. Then it's in a, this is the same as, this is the same as this. Okay, this is what we'll show. We must show that W double annihilator is W. The proof will make use of the fact that dimension of W plus dimension annihilator of W is equal to dimension of V, which we proved last time. Whenever W is a subspace, dimension W plus dimension W naught is equal to dimension of V. The annihilator of W, the dimension of the annihilator of W satisfies this. I can do this for the double annihilator. That happens in V star. Dimension of the annihilator of W plus dimension of the double annihilator of W, that must be equal to dimension of V star. This is happening in V star. this happens in V star, and so this is equal to dimension of V star. All these equations make sense. V is finite dimensional, so V star is finite dimensional. Cancel the right hand sides. Right hand sides are the same. So this minus this, this minus this. So I'm I'm subtracting one from the other. It follows dimension W is dimension double annihilator. Okay, and so these subspaces are the same dimension. I want to show that W is equal to the double annihilator. Is it enough if I show that one subspace is contained in the other? Then it will follow that the subspaces are the same. Okay, so we'll show that W is contained in the double annihilator. It will then follow that W is equal to W double annihilator. Again, this must be understood in the sense of the identification. W is a subset of V. W double annihilator is a subset of V double star, but we must use the identification coming from the isomorphism phi. Okay, let me write down W naught. W naught by definition is a set of all functionals that take the value 0 for all vectors in W. So it is a set of all f in V star such that let us say f of x is equal to 0 for all x in W. This is W naught, the first annihilator. What is a double annihilator? The double annihilator is a set of all L in V double star. Set of all L in V double star such that W annihilator is a subspace. It is L in V star says that L of F is equal to 0 for all F in W naught. This is a double annihilator. I have just used the same definition as the previous one. Notation is different. Previously W is in V, so it is a vector. Here these are linear functionals. Okay, now write this in their expanded form. Identify with this L is in V double star, so there is an identification with a vector in V. Use that identification, you will be able to show that W is contained in the double annihilator. Okay, this is the set of all, let us say L in V double star, such that set of all Lx in, I know that each L in V double star is of the form Lx, each element is of the form Lx, phi is an isomorphism. So it is set of all Lx in V double star such that 0 equals Lx of f, that is Fx by definition. This for all f, all that I have done is to remember that any L in V double star is of the form Lx. But this Lx I told you can be identified with x. So I will use x itself. Set of all x in V double star, I am identifying that with V. So set of all x in V such that I will just use the last equation, f of x equals 0 for all f in W. This is the double annihilator. Set of all x in V such that f x equal to 0 for all f in W star. So I have made use of the identification. Lx can be identified with x, and the rest is just use this. I have removed Lx now, fx equal to 0 for all f in W naught. Okay, there is only one last step. What is that last step? Let x element of W, then for all f in W naught, f of x equals 0 by definition. That is x belongs to W, W perpendicular. W perpendicular, we now know, is a set of all x that are sent to 0 by any linear functional that is in W naught, right? It is a set of all x that is sent to 0 by any linear functional in W naught. If x is in W, then for any linear functional f in W naught, fx is 0. So if x is in W, then x must be in W, double annihilator. So W is contained in a double annihilator. Two subspaces having the same dimension with one contained in the other means they are the same. Okay, this is another consequence. When you do the double annihilator, you could identify that with the subspace that you started with. Okay, so let me stop here. In the next lecture, I will discuss the notion of the dual linear transformation of a linear transformation and then derive two natural results. One result that we proved earlier, that the row rank is equal to the column rank, this was proved using linear equations, homogeneous equations, then row reduced echelon forms, etc. We'll give a conceptual proof this time, okay, without calculations. A conceptual proof of the fact that the row rank of a linear transformation is equal to row rank of a matrix is the column rank of the matrix, and also how are the matrices of a linear transformation and its transpose related. If T is a linear transformation, A is the matrix of the linear transformation relative to a basis, then what is the matrix of the linear transformation T transpose relative to two particular bases? We will observe that it is the transpose of the matrix of the linear transformation that we started with. Okay, so these notions, these results we will prove next time.